He, head of the Korean Cultural Freedom Foundation and its project Radio Free Asia, to appear today to answer questions regarding allegations that he had official ties with the government of the Republic of Korea in connection with Korean attempts to influence U.S. policy and opinion. Colonel Park declined to appear voluntarily as a witness in 1976, and again this year he's appearing under subpoena today. Colonel Park, would you raise your right hand, please? You do solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give to this subcommittee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Washington, D.C., capital of the United States. Yet in reality, it is also the capital of the free world today. Its lofty Capitol building rises impressively above the skyline. The statues of Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln stand as prominent landmarks. Washington is the universal symbol of democracy. This is the White House. From this house, the President of the United States carries out his duties and implements policies which shape not only the destiny of America, but that of the world. In 1972, Washington was shaken by a shocking political scandal called Watergate, which ended only after forcing President Richard M. Nixon out of the White House. As the Watergate era came to a close, the media looked eagerly for another such exciting event. Enter Tongson Park, a Korean businessman accused of bribing the United States Congress. Unavoidably, this investigation focused on South Korea. Among the congressional committees investigating KoreaGate was one headed by Congressman Donald M. Fraser, chairman of the House Subcommittee on International Organizations. He chose Reverend Sun Myung-moon and the Unification Church as targets upon which to make his mark. One may ask, why Reverend Moon? The answers are obvious. First, Reverend Moon is the most well-known Korean in the United States. Second, his religious views and anti-communist stand have generated controversy in many quarters. Therefore, he appeared to Mr. Fraser to be an ideal and easy target. Reverend Moon felt called by God to come to America. His purpose was to begin a new spiritual movement in America. During the next 5 years, his movement became a whirlwind. The initial welcome Reverend Moon received was heartwarming. In more than 800 American cities and towns, he was given honorary keys, citizenship, and letters of appreciation. In September 1974, at the Waldorf Astoria in New York City, Reverend Moon held a Day of Hope banquet. Distinguished guests from many fields gathered to mark the inauguration of yet another spiritual crusade. Here, Reverend Moon was introduced to the guests, and he received a most enthusiastic welcome. Mrs. Moon was also welcomed. On September 18th, 1974, a rally was held in Madison Square Garden. It was an unprecedented success. Over 60,000 people came to hear Reverend Moon, but only 35,000 could fit into the hall. Reverend Moon proclaims the realistic building of the actual kingdom of God on earth. Many of America's youth who are seeking spiritual truth, direction for their lives, and hope for the future follow him. Reverend Moon's crusade soon spread to Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Chicago, Atlanta, Seattle, San Francisco, and Los Angeles. And in every city, he raised the beacon of spiritual revolution. Finally, his crusade and this spiritual fire reached all 50 states. This is New York's Yankee Stadium. Here in 1976, on the occasion of America's bicentennial, Reverend Moon held the God Bless America Festival to congratulate the nation on the 200th anniversary of its independence. He prayed for God to bless America as it entered its third century. He urged all Americans to uphold the founding spirit of America, the spirit of a God-centered America. Then on September 18th, 1976, he held the greatest religious rally in the history of Washington. Over 300,000 people gathered at the Washington Monument. It was here he proclaimed that America must continue its search for truth under the banner of One World Under God. This spiritual movement, created by a man from Korea, has inevitably been taken as a threat by some established quarters. Moreover, the international communists and the leftists in America regard Reverend Moon's victory over communism philosophy as disturbing. As a result, from both left and right, Reverend Moon and the Unification Church have been harassed and persecuted. Some people wanted to block Reverend Moon and his movement. One such person who took advantage of this situation was Mr. Donald M. Fraser. Mr. Fraser follows a far leftist political line and is a well-known opponent of the Korean government. For him, Koreagate was a golden opportunity. He sought to link the Unification Church with the Korean CIA in order both to defame Reverend Moon and destroy the Unification Church in America. Also, he sought to embarrass the Korean government. In the process, he tried to create political capital for himself to use later in his campaign for the Senate. The morning of March 22, 1978, Chairman Fraser proudly interrogated the former Secretary of State, Henry Kissinger. That afternoon, he called Mr. Bo Hee Pak, special assistant to Reverend Moon. In three open sessions and two closed, five sessions in all, Mr. Pak confronted the committee without fear. He gave his testimony not as one accused, but rather as the accuser. He defended his faith, the honor of Reverend Moon, and the reputation of his church. He defended his country, Korea, with passion, and fearlessly attacked Congressman Fraser's anti-Korea policy.
I would like to make it clear that I have been resisting this investigation adamantly. Why? Not because I have something to hide, not because I'm afraid of any exposure, but because of the way this investigation was motivated and conducted, because of the lack of objectivity and a sensitivity to what kind of impact this investigation is making upon many innocent people, not only in this country, but around the world. Today, I'm indeed a citizen of the Republic of Korea, and I'm an immigrant to this great nation of immigrants. Four of my six children were born in this country, and they are American citizens. Certainly, I have a loyalty to my heritage of Korea, but I owe my life to America. My loyalty to America is just as strong as that to my own country. Here I am today in the United States Congress, summoned by this august subcommittee on international organizations headed by you, Mr. Chairman. I stand here not as a proud witness, but more as the accused, accused as an agent or spy of a foreign country, accused as a KCIA agent, accused as a running dog of the foreign government. Nothing could be further from the truth. I know I have been none of those things. Then why am I here today? Why am I singled out? I do know one thing. I'm here today because I'm a Korean, disciple Reverend Moon, and a member of Unification Church, and a dedicated anti-communist. Korean, this word is a dirty word in these days, and everything Korean is suspect. Also, to be a Moonie in this country is very unpopular, and the cause for anti-communism is practically dead now. Yet I'm all of those unpopular things. I may look like a fool, Mr. Chairman. I will not recant, however, any of those qualifications. I'm a proud Korean, a proud Moonie, and a dedicated anti-communist, and I intend to remain so the rest of my life. Yet this is not all. I'm particularly anguished over the fact that the noble work of the man who came to this country to preach the gospel has been so misunderstood and mistreated. Reverend Moon preached in every state and the most major cities of America numerous times in the last several years. I believe his work is unparalleled by any religious leader in this country. His vision ignited so many disillusioned American youth, and he became a symbol of hope to them. But now the divine work has suffered under this unfounded, vicious attack. The damage is all the more serious because since it is happening in America, its impact is not confined to America alone. American news travel everywhere. Reverend Moon, disciples, and the missionaries in 127 countries are being falsely accused due to these false allegations. We are scared of the communist takeover. We fear this happening so much that we would give our very lives to stop it. We saw our small country practically overrun by communists in 1950. I fought that war. We have had millions killed and are taken to the north. We cannot afford to have the same situation happen again. Too much blood, too much tragedy. Our hearts bleed as we remember such things. With any amount of sacrifice necessary, we cannot allow another invasion from the north. With the above situation, the Korean government must have been concerned and irritated by the planned withdrawal of the United States troops announced in 1970. Of course, the Korean people were disheartened by the prospect of the U.S. withdrawal. Government, as well as the people, know that the U.S. presence is essential and vital for our national security. Both the government and the people have become very desperate, and they want to do something about it. This is a natural instinct for survival. In a few more years, North Korea would not even dare to plan an outright attack on South Korea because the power difference between North Korea and South Korea would be so staggering. Was not the U.S. looking forward to the day when Korea would become totally self-sufficient and the danger of war would be totally eliminated? Korea has made great achievements toward that goal. The last thing I want to see is that Korea to become another Vietnam. Mr. Chairman, in conclusion, I would like to make one final plea. Anything I have said today, however slight, that disturbed you, please forgive me. I said I have nothing against you personally. Let us think for a moment about destiny. Destiny of two countries, USA and Korea. It has an especial destiny. America liberated this one small peninsula from the hand of foreign imperial powers in 1945 and gave birth to a new nation in 1948. In 1950, the U.S. in the person of Harry S. Truman committed to the defense of Korea from North Korean communist aggression. In 3 years, America lost more than 30,000 gallant men. Many more tens of thousands were wounded. Indeed, this indicates a special destiny. It is truly beyond human comprehension, and no man could have mapped out this course. It is God-inspired, a preordained destiny, I believe. On the other hand, there are international forces dedicated to see to it that Korea would become another Vietnam. There are people and nations who are dying to see free Korea destroyed. These people are not just sitting around waiting, doing nothing. They're doing everything possible to guarantee this would happen. If they should ever succeed, Korea would become another Vietnam. This would be a tragic day for the United States and for the world. Yes, Korea cannot survive without the United States, because Korea's enemy is not just Kim Il-sung, but Russia and Red China as well. But ultimately, the United States would not survive without Korea either. Why? For two reasons. Korea is in a geographically strategic position and essential to the future freedom of the world. If Korea turns into a second Vietnam, there would be a third Vietnam. That may very well be Japan. Then who would be the fourth Vietnam? This investigation has a quality to be used and exploited by our potential enemy, and it might permanently cripple the relationship of the two countries, thus pushing Korea one step closer to another Vietnam. And you are holding the two-edged sword in the palm of your hand, sir. Future history will record just how you use the two-edged sword. Mr. Chairman, there is an old Korean saying that goes, in trying to pull up the horn, you may kill the cow. And there is an American saying, you may win the battle, but lose the war. For God's sake, please uphold the God-inspired destiny of our two nations. I plead with you, sir, that you must win the battle and the war. Do not kill the cow while pulling at the horn.
How long a time are you speaking of, Colonel? How much time?
I know time is essence, and our prepared page is 23 pages. However, I made my conscientious effort to shorten as short as possible, bare minimum down to 15 pages. I even bought the stopwatches to measure the time. And it took me 19 minutes, 45 seconds. And it is imperative for me to have this 19 minutes. And I'd like to ask Mr. Chairman that he give this opportunity to register my side of the feeling and my side of the story as I see it. Because just answering, Mr. Chairman, your question, that does not bring out the truth that as we see it.
Well, Colonel, I'm sorry if your answers to the questions don't produce the truth, but that's all we're trying to get at. We'll give you 5 minutes and no more. If you can make whatever points you want in 5 minutes, we'll be delighted to hear you. But 5 minutes, it seems to me, is entirely adequate in view of the enormous amount of time you've had already.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to really plea you once again that I'd like to have this 19 minutes.
Colonel, we're quite prepared to have your entire statement put in the record. You can just make your principal points in 5 minutes.
Yes, I do know it can be put into a record, but however, you know, that
Colonel,
the reason I want to read this because I'm not only just speaking the words, but my soul and heart and anguish and so forth, and these things cannot be entered into the record. I'd like to...
Colonel, if we don't have an agreement on the 5 minutes, I think we'll simply proceed with the questions. You can have your choice. If you want to take 5 minutes, that'll be fine. Otherwise, we'll just go directly to the questions.
I will ask for 15 minutes, sir.
I'll tell you what, Colonel, we'll split the difference. How's 10 minutes?
Mr. Chairman, it doesn't make too much difference. I will stay an hour longer or even up to midnight. Could you kindly give me 5 more minutes? I said 15 minutes, even though it takes me 19 minutes, 45 seconds.
All right, Colonel, start your stopwatch and we'll go for 15 minutes.
And what the Reverend Moon stands for. Number one, he stands for God and God-centered ideology. Also, Reverend Moon absolutely opposes communism, which is the enemy of God and men. Number two, he stands for a strong anti-communist Korea and a strong God-centered America. Reverend Moon believes that Korea and America should stand united in a common cause against the forces of communist tyranny. These, then, are two of the most important things which Reverend Moon stands for. You, Mr. Chairman, are absolutely determined to destroy him and everything he stands for. Could that mean that you stand for the opposite? Does it mean that, Mr. Chairman, that you favor the communist cause? Does it mean that you seek to destroy Korea, perhaps create a second Vietnam there, disrupt the Korean-American relation? According to reliable press accounts, shortly after the fall of Vietnam, you circulate a dear colleague memo to your fellow congressmen, which expressed your satisfaction that your involvement in Vietnam, our involvement in Vietnam, had finally drawn to an end. You suggested further that the time had come to review our involvement in Korea as well. Is this the beginning of your campaign to get Korea? How else we can explain the things you have done? History of the subcommittee activities under your leadership, coupled with your own personal commitment, demonstrate that you have consistently supported pro-communist causes and groups and sought to undermine anti-communist governments and individuals, often using human rights as a smokescreen. This subcommittee, Mr. Chairman, has spent so far 34 months and over $500,000 investigating alleged wrongdoings of the Korean government. Yet you devoted only 1.5 days investigating the genocide in Cambodia, one of the most terrible human rights crimes in history. An article on September 23, 1976, in the Congressional Record Report, and another Socialist Workers' Party front, which you, Mr. Chairman, lent your name in support of, the Political Rights Defense Fund, set up to coordinate Socialist Workers' Party lawsuits against the FBI. The report mentioned one lawsuit, which you support charging the FBI with illegal surveillance of the Socialist Workers' Party. It seems strange to me that you condemn the FBI for surveillance for a known communist and potentially violent organization and say nothing about the U.S. government's illegal surveillance of the Korean Blue House, which is a clear violation of Korean law and the human rights of the Korean people. The most serious allegation against you, Mr. Chairman, was made by a former Polish communist intelligence operator, Jonas Kochanski, who defected to the United States. Walter Riley reports in a 1977 Dateline Washington that Mr. Kochanski, the defected head of several Polish intelligence networks and a director of the Department of Pol living abroad, testified under oath that Representative Donald Frazier worked as an agent of influence on Capitol Hill for the Soviet Union. Suppose the Korean government had taken extraordinary steps involving hundreds of agents to win influence in United States Congress, then we must ask, why would they do it? What would be Korea's purpose and ultimate goal? To subvert America? To destroy or defeat America? Absolutely not. Korea is motivated by the most simple human instinct, survival. That is the bottom line. Korea wants to survive, not at the expense of America, but together with America. You know that, Mr. Chairman, yet you continue to seek to destroy that relationship. Why? On the other hand, what is Moscow's motivation? What does the Soviet Union stand for? And what is it seeking? Nothing less than the total destruction of America and the defeat of the free world. Recent issue of Time magazine, February 6, 1978, reported on the phenomenal growth and outreach of the KGB. In this issue of Time, it said that KGB spent over $10 billion a year with 500,000 employees and has five times the number of foreign agents as the U.S. and Western Europe combined. But you have never spent one red cent investigating the activities of the KGB in America. This subcommittee would seem ideally structured to undertake the task. Instead, you have spent 34 months and $685,000 investigating probably innocuous attempts of an American ally to shore up its relationship with your country. Today, in this subcommittee hearing room, we have raised the portentous questions which demand answers. What if, as the evidence suggests, you, Mr. Chairman, are secretly working to undermine Korean-American relations? What if you are an ardent supporter of the Trotskyist Communist Socialist Workers' Party? What if you are an agent of influence for Moscow here on Hill? If these things are true, then the government of the United States is itself in grave danger. America's very survival and the security of the free world are at stake. Reverend Moon has come to this country not for his own sake, but to awaken America to the threat of communism, and through America to awaken the whole world. In opposition to the God-denying ideology of communism, Reverend Moon is proclaiming a God-centered ideology. His only goal is to inspire others to work together to build God-centered families, nations, and a God-centered world.
In a difficult battle, Mr. Park is as tough as the situation requires. But at home, another side emerges. He is a family man and a good father. He has a wife, Ki-Suk Park, and six children. Reverend Moon teaches that the family is the building block of the Kingdom of Heaven. Mr. Park and his family attempt to live up to that ideal. In June 1950, when the Korean War broke out, Mr. Park was a cadet at the Korean Military Academy. The very day the war broke out, he was sent to the front line to fight. 7 years later, in 1957, now a major in the Korean Army, Mr. Park met Reverend Moon. In 1961, while a major in the Korean Army, Mr. Bohee-pak was selected for diplomatic duty as the assistant military attaché at the Korean Embassy in Washington, D.C. In recognition of his outstanding service as a diplomat, he received a citation from the Prime Minister of the Republic of Korea. Hoping to spread understanding of the heart and culture of Korea, he brought the Little Angels, the children's folk ballet of Korea, to all corners of the globe.
We are very honored to present a special holiday program of the Little Angels. This program is presented for the benefit of the United Nations Children's Fund.
He was the only Korean to speak at the United Nations General Assembly Hall as a private citizen. He taught the little angels love of country. At The Hague, he led the children in the laying of flowers on the tomb of the Korean patriot, Lee Jun, who gave his life in an attempt to save the independence of Korea. In 1971, Mr. Park and the Little Angels were invited for a royal command performance in the presence of Her Majesty the Queen of England in London. After the performance, they were guests at a special royal reception. But Mr. Park's main mission is to spread God's word. He serves Reverend Moon as his special assistant and principal interpreter. In addition, when he is on his own, he also teaches Reverend Moon's new revelation throughout the United States, Japan, and many other nations of the world. Often working all through the night at his quiet Washington office, he prepared for the fight at the Fraser hearing. He prepared not just his words, but also his soul. The real source of Mr. Park's power is his faith, faith instilled in him by the teachings of Reverend Sun Myung Moon, whom he regards as a modern-day prophet and spiritual father. He believes in the power of prayer, and he often prays together with his family. As a man dedicated to God, his life has not been usual or mundane. God has given him many rare responsibilities which he never anticipated or asked for. It seems to be destiny, for once again God gave him the responsibility to represent his nation, his faith, and his church at the United States Congress when they were unjustly attacked by the Congressional Committee.
Chairman, when I read this article, my mind and body are consumed with anger. And I am Reverend Moon's disciple. Although I am an imperfect disciple, there's one thing that is absolutely sure. I do live by God's moral code and principle taught by Reverend Moon, and I shall continue to do so the rest of my life. Yet, my honor has been destroyed. You did it. What right do you have to destroy me? Is that your human right? Then where is my human right? Since I do not believe in an eye for eye, all I can do is pray for you. You shall surely reap what you have sown. This is a lie. You are the author of this information. And you gave this lie to the power of the United States Congress. This is the worst character assassination possible. You did this to the man who came to America to do the work of God and save, yes, save his country from immorality. I cannot help but believe that you are being used as instrument of devil. You, yes, instrument of the devil. I said it. Who else would want to destroy a man of God but the devil? Mr. Chairman, indeed this subcommittee has become a witch hunt, kangaroo court. You see an opportunity to make a killing for your political campaign. You needed a target. Reverend Moon and the Unification Church and a struggling South Korea have become the ideal target. Do you think you can become a senator at the cost of the blood, honor, and the lives of innocent people? You will find innocent blood very costly. I say to you what St. Thomas, who has been brought to trial on the charges of treason, by Henry VIII, the sticking to his own religious conviction, said to Sir Richard, who had perjured himself in testimony against St. Thomas in order to advance his own career, even at the cost of the saint's blood. Quoting Jesus, St. Thomas said, "For what will it profit a man if he gain the whole world and forfeit his soul?" For this he was beheaded. Mr. Chairman, I know it is easy and unpopular in the short run to prosecute new religious groups. So it was for Nero. So it was for Julian the Apostate. But does history remember them for their social reform, or foreign policy, or even human rights? No, it remembers them as a great persecutor in history. And so history might remember Donald Fraser, if it remembers him at all. You may get my scalp, Mr. Chairman. Go ahead. But never my heart and soul. My heart and soul belong to God. The Lord is my shepherd. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm ready, sir. Thank you.
I am a proud Korean and a proud Mooney. I cannot let my country, my spiritual father, my faith, and my church be shamed. I am willing to fight with my life, Mr. Park said over and over. Reverend Moon's prayer was always with him. And finally, justice was done. On September 13, 1978, Congressman Donald Fraser, who was a chairman of a powerful subcommittee, had abused his power, lost his primary election in a senatorial race. With this defeat, he lost his congressional seat altogether. Mr. Fraser's defeat, however, was not an ordinary one. Political analysts were unanimous in predicting a Fraser landslide. On election eve, his victory seemed certain. At midnight, the press declared Fraser victor. There was great celebration, and he went to bed happy. The next day, the early morning papers even declared in big headlines, Fraser beats out Short. But during the night, a miracle had been quietly in the making. When Fraser woke up the next morning, he found that he had lost by a small margin. It was an unbelievable upset defeat. Mr. Fraser's attempt to use Reverend Moon and the Unification Church for political gain backfired. In the end, truth prevailed. Shortly after Mr. Fraser's election defeat, the subcommittee issued its final report. The Unification Church was proven innocent, and Reverend Moon's honor was restored. In Seoul, Reverend Moon broke his long silence and asked his church to forgive Mr. Fraser and pray for his soul. But he also added, Mr. Fraser's defeat was more than political fortune. It was an act of justice.